When you say, you know, cap rates, capitalization rates, and you know, most stabilized, you know, in large MSAs are trading between, you know, 4% and 6% cap rates. Can you kind of explain what determines a cap rate, or like, because when you're buying something, you don't want to buy it at a six cap, obviously, like you just said, you want to be buying it somewhere probably between an 8 and a 10, and then you want to exit it at that retail.
Yes. So there's a lot, there's a couple complexities in that. The thing is, like, if you're buying a value, all right, so let's define cap rate first. A cap rate is essentially this exact same thing as a return on investment or an unleveraged yield. It's as if you bought that building cash, what would your return on investment be? So if I came in and I bought an apartment building with cash, you know, million-dollar apartment building that yielded $100,000 in net operating income. That means my cap rate at my basis would be 10%, right? But the market cap rate, it's kind of like it's capitalism, right? It's what are people in these areas buying properties for? At what sort of cap rates are properties trading for? That is where the comparable approach does come in, because you're looking at what other buildings sold for on a cap rate basis. But just because that's a 100-unit building and you got a 100-unit building doesn't mean that you're going to sell for the same price per unit, because they might be a lot better at generating revenue or saving on expenses than what our building could be doing, right? Or vice versa. So you can't look at it from a price per unit basis. You have to look at the NOI. But a cap rate is return on investment or unleveraged yield. If I bought this thing cash, what kind of return on investment would I have? And that's my return on investment or my cap rate at my cost basis, but it could be valued at something very different in that marketplace. If you're buying in a marketplace that trades at a 5% cap, then that building's worth $2 million, right? So there's two cap rates that you're looking at. What is the return on investment cap rate for me at my cost basis? And then what is the market value as well? And yes, you want a delta to be there. For my model, I essentially do the BRRRR method, the buy, renovate, rent, refinance for apartment buildings. So I need to be able to buy it, renovate it, put good tenants in place, put good management in place, and then refinance it inside a couple of years. And I create appreciation. I force that appreciation up because I increase the income and decrease the expenses. And that allows me to then be all into a $10 million building for $7 million. Right. So it's worth $10 million because it nets, let's call it $600,000 a year, and it's at a 6% cap rate. So it's worth $10 million. But at my cost basis, I'm all into it for $7 million. It's really like a 9% cap rate at my cost basis. It's a 9% cap rate to me. So do you guys understand there's two different rates that you're looking at? So that's a one thing to address. The other thing that you mentioned, Sharud, is that the your going in cap rate and the refinance or stabilized cap rate, you want to go in, you know, at a higher cap rate or sell at a lower cap rate. Yeah, but if you think about it, I buy distressed stuff. A lot of times it's a 0% cap rate that I'm buying it at. Does that make sense? But once it's stabilized, then it's a 10% cap or a 9% cap to me at my cost basis. So I'm again, it kind of goes back to, I'm not really concerned about what is it performing at right now. I'm concerned about what can it perform at once I stabilize this property. And once I do stabilize it, then what kind of yield, unleveraged yield, am I going to get at my cost basis? And what does that delta look like? Meaning, if I can get, typically you want probably a 2 to 3 point delta if you want to follow my BRRRR method, right? The way that I buy those kinds of properties. So if a area is trading at a 6% cap rate, I usually need to be in that 8-8.5% cap rate at my cost basis. It might have a 0% cap rate when I buy it because it's distressed and it's all beat up, it's got bad management in place, it's not performing. But in that 12 to 24 month time frame, I need it to be generating, you know, X number of dollars to yield me an 8-8.5% return on my investment or unleveraged yield.
Yeah, no, see, that's what I love about multifamily and storage units, that forced appreciation. You can just find something completely mismanaged, and not often, but you can not even swing a hammer and change the value of that property just by changing some numbers on the paper, on the P&Ls. Like, it's beautiful.
Yeah, and it's like the scale of it's insane. If you had a 100-unit apartment building, let me give you like an example. Let's say you got a 100-unit apartment building. What amount of rent is so nominal that nobody would ever move out of their apartment building for that, or out of their apartment unit? What would you say?
Like 20 bucks, right? We just do 20 bucks.
Yeah. Let's call it 20 bucks. You're going to bump the rent up 20 bucks across the whole board. Let's say you never touch anything in the property. You never renovate a unit. You never reduce the utility expenses. You didn't even shop the insurance. You didn't do anything other than over the next 12 months, you bump up rents on every single unit by $20 per month. So we got $20 times 100 units equals $2,000 a month times 12 months is an extra $24,000 a year. Eh, that's cool, $24,000 a year. But look what it does to the value. If you divide that at a 6% cap rate, it increases the value of the building by $400,000 for doing something that nobody ever bats an eye at.
Yeah.
You just increase your net worth by 400 grand just by holding the property for 12 months and bumping up rents by 20 bucks a month. That's it. So you can see how you can very predictably increase the value. God forbid you actually renovate a unit, right? Or actually install low flow water fixtures, and you reduce the expenses and you increase that income, and you add laundry and you add, you know, signage, or you add parking, or you do some of these things to generate additional revenue and then do some other things to reduce the expenses. That NOI, as it grows, it's not just the cash flow that grows. It's the exponential factor of what it does to the value of the building.